is the second Sunday of Lent, and as a spiritual discipline, we'll be considering prayer. Please listen very carefully to very familiar words this morning. I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version, so it'll be a teeny bit different than what we just recited together. This is Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13, and of course, Jesus is talking with his disciples. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. Do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. And that is where the prayer ends in most translations of the gospel. The King James is what has that added, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Please join me in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Our Wednesday Bible study group has begun reading John Dominic Crossan's very insightful book called The Greatest Prayer. We're using a study guide that was prepared by the UCC Justice Ministries to help us take a fresh look at those words that we know so well. Crossan calls the prayer Christianity's most important prayer, but also the strangest prayer because of what it doesn't say. There is no doctrine. There is nothing that ties it to any branch of Christianity whatsoever, or even to Christianity. If you think about it, it could be prayed by any religious group that worships God. He says that it's a revolutionary manifesto and a hymn of hope. Revolutionary because it calls for God's justice to cover the earth, and a hymn because of its poetic form, which carries forward images of Hebrew scripture poetry. This prayer, in its few words, joins all of us who say these words in a team with God, uniting our hearts in search of God's ideal for all the inhabitants of earth and for earth itself. That's what prayer is, the joining of our mind, our heart, and our spirit with the Spirit of God, so that our communication is an interaction with the Holy Spirit. As we look at these words and phrases, keep in mind that Jesus was not a 21st century American Christian. His faith was rooted deeply in Judaism. He knew his Hebrew scriptures well. He understood the Torah. He could grasp the meaning of the words of the prophets as they called for the people to live in harmony with God. Jesus was telling people to remember their roots. He was urging them to live together in the ways God intended, without an oppressive system of power and control, without distinctions with people that bestowed value on some and denied the humanity and worth of others. He was turning social convention upside down, declaring children, women, poor people, the sick, the disabled, and the foreigners equal with the wealthy and the elite. The man with the mission to set society right is the one who shared this model for prayer with us. This language is not quite as straightforward as we might think. In Hebrew and in Greek, nouns have attached pronouns. Old manuscripts will have the prayer begin, Abba, our Father. The Hebrew word Abba is a special relationship, kind of like our word daddy. It implies a closeness, far different than a formal word of father. In Greek translations, Abba is not translated, but is left in Hebrew because of the special relationship that word invokes in the mind of the reader. So when we recite our Father, We aren't just reaching out to a distant authority, but to our Daddy, who is a father to all of us. While the word choice includes masculine gender in our minds, Crossan suggests that in this case, father is more of an indication of head of household, the one in charge of things, the one responsible for making sure that everyone was cared for with justice, the one who distributes fairly so that each has their daily bread. We recognize God's location as heaven, and we offer our worship and praise by declaring that even God's name is holy. The next phrase makes a request, "Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven." It is a request for the just householder to establish a world where all have enough, where all are valued, where all are treated fairly. Remember, Jesus spent his ministry sharing the message of God's desire for us to care for the orphan, the widow, and the stranger in our midst. This prayer includes them in the kingdom that Jesus wants to see on earth. That statement, "Thy kingdom come," is not just a request, but also a commitment to join in the work to bring about that shalom where nobody is hungry, nobody lacks safe, clean water, nobody is in need of shelter, nobody is denied health care, nobody lives in fear of the government, nobody is excluded from worship, nobody is denied dignity, nobody lives in fear of anything. God's kingdom is God's household. It is the entire earth. When we pray this prayer, we unite ourselves with the mission of bringing about God's household of justice that includes all of creation. When we pray, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," we aren't asking God to make puppets of all living things. We are, once again, joining our hearts and our minds with the heart of God. We're declaring that we will be actively seeking God's will and striving to live within that will. We dedicate ourselves to knowing God well enough to be able to identify the will of God in all decisions so that all of our actions honor this God we call Abba. The prayer begins with a triplet of worship offered to God. Hallowed is your name, your kingdom come, and your will be done. The second half is also a triplet. Give us our daily bread, forgive our debts as we forgive, and lead us. First, we offer our praise and ourselves to God. Then we make our requests to God to continue to care for us as part of the household. The prayer does not ask God to make us rich. It doesn't ask God to put us in positions of great power so we can dominate others. It doesn't ask God to make our lives easy peasy. It asks for enough. Our daily bread is a request for God to sustain us, all of us. Not just the ones with money, but all people. May we all have food on this day. Just like the Israelites were fed manna in the wilderness, feed us, God. Take care of us the way you took care of our ancestors when they were totally dependent on you. Because even when we forget this truth, we too are totally dependent on you, God. We're trusting you to provide for us. We're including everyone in the us. Us is a really big word for something with only two letters in it. It's inclusive. It's everybody, everywhere, with no exceptions. Forgive us our debts is another very important phrase to first century Jews. It declares Jubilee, the year of the Lord's favor that was supposed to be recognized every 7 years, just like a Sabbath of rest. And even the soil got to take a break, and all people were released from all kinds of debt. No more exclusion from participation in the life of the faith community because you couldn't pay your temple tax. no more oppressive debt to the landlord who charged so much for the privilege of being a sharecropper that there was not enough left to feed your family. No more debt. Not even a debt to God for all that God does for us all the time. Grace. A clean slate that says we are valued so much by God that God isn't keeping score of the many gifts we're receiving. In gratitude for that grace, we offer the same gift to others as we promise to reciprocate forgiveness of indebtedness to us. Unlike Sheldon Cooper on The Big Bang Theory, who's very hung up on keeping relationships balanced, we won't keep track of what we do for others so that we can expect them to do something of the same value for us. We won't worry about who owes a dinner or who owes a few hours of childcare or a ride to the store or any of the other ways we can feel we are owed something by someone. We offer the same grace to others as our Daddy in heaven pours out on us. Olly, olly, out's in free. The game is over. And everybody is the winner. We are trading in our desire to be better than our neighbor for the freedom to love our neighbor like we are loved. The final phrase asks for God to offer us direction and protection. Show us the path for our lives and keep us from being influenced by evil. Build a force field around us so that we aren't enticed by evil to be greedy or to seek power, or to rule over others, or to step on anyone in order to climb the ladder of success, or to judge a sister or brother as other, separate from us, and worth less than us. Deliver us from the evil of indifference. Deliver us from the evil of insulation that keeps us from noticing the needs of others. Deliver us from the evil of being less than your vision for us. Deliver us from the evil of being small when we were created to do so much and to be so much. Way back in Genesis, in the creation stories, humans were given dominion over the earth. We were entrusted to care for all that lives and for all that God made, the water, the soil, the air, the plants, and all of the animals. Dominion wasn't meant to be absolute authority to use and abuse as we choose. It was meant to be like the title in the first line of our prayer, Dominion and Father, the householder who makes sure that all is in order and all is cared for. God has trusted us with everything and everyone that God holds dear. When we pray this greatest prayer, we're making a promise to God to live up to that trust. We join ourselves with God as a team to make the household of God a place where all have enough and nobody is on the bottom of the social scale. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, because we are being led not into temptation, but away from the evil of injustice and indifference. May this prayer be for us call to solidarity with God and a call to action. May it never be a bunch of words we mouth without thinking. May it be for us the greatest prayer and the greatest desire of our hearts. Amen.